About fiqh al-waqa, we're going to have it inshallah. Yes.
So al-wahy, revelation. So is Quran, and we know the sunnah. Three ways: either what Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, or his actions, or what he has approved. So are all these
events
that
we
have approved, are they all wahi, or how come?
All wahi. Okay. All wahi. Everything from the Prophet is wahi. Everything. Tayyib. Now, as you see, did you understand the difference between maqasid, the intent of the Sharia, and usul fiqh? So the maqasid is the spirit of the Sharia. What really Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for His servant. He wants for them rahmah. He wants them to live into fairness and justice. The objective of the whole Sharia is the well-being of the universe. That's the intent of the Sharia. There's no nikay in the Sharia. There's no like, the law of the Sharia is to hurt people, is to destroy. There's no such a thing. How can the most merciful have in his intent of revelation to destroy and corrupt? The punishment comes for those who want to spread the mischief which contradict with the intent of the Sharia, which is the well-being of everyone. Tayyib. Now, you see the categories here of the words. We put them into categories to understand which one of the words that intent for us, you know, to do that with an obligation, you know, with the option. We don't have option, or like that said, watch the words of the Quran, of the Sunnah of the Prophet. When we read it, we understand this is an action that we do have to do by obligation. So that's where comes the sulfaq. That's where comes the sulfaq. Now I'll go more into details of the meaning of the usul fiqh. As we said, it's the spirit of the law. This is going to be... Can you hear me? I cannot walk. I'm tired by this. You just lift it, yep. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, no, this angle for the sister. Can you pull it this way? Yeah, that's it. Yeah, for me too. So it can work. There it is. I feel like that. We have, we're going to need this again. We have usul al-fiqh, and we have fiqh. The fiqh, which is the law of the jurisprudence, is the implementation of the law. But both usul fiqh, they need two things. Laws and evidence, which is proofs. Okay? The same for the fiqh. Law and evidence. But the law and the evidence of the fiqh are different from the law and the evidence of usul fiqh. Again, we started from the revelation, which are the words of Allah and His messengers. Studying those words, we put them into categories to know which words mean for us, and we put them into the categories of obligatory, mandub, mubah, makruh, haram, etc. Right? I'm going to take now the fiqh away. Why? Because to tell you that the structure are the same, laws and evidence. If we come to the law and evidence of usul fiqh, we take this one here. Or let's start with the evidences. The evidence, which is the source of the law, the proof of the law. If I tell you pray, say, why you ask me to do this? He said, Allah told you to do so. Where Allah told me? He said it in the Quran. So the evidence for us to pray is in the Quran. That's why he said, give me your dalil. Your dalil is the evidence. So the evidence of the law of usul fiqh are the evidence, are in fact the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah, and then we're going to study more sources, which is al-ijma'u, al-qiyasu. But this is, you know, they come like ramification comes out of the Quran and the Sunnah. They're not, I mean, the source we want in this presentation to just, be restricted now to the most principal ones, because we're going to study the qiyas and the ijma', those something else. But they are from the Quran and the Sunnah. Now, when we say the evidence of the usul of fiqh, Quran of the Sunnah, which is mean exactly to come to these laws. What are these laws of the usul of fiqh? Are these here? So, when I say this is an action that I'm obligated to do, say, what is your evidence? I said, my evidence from the Quran of the Sunnah. So here is a principle, is not an action itself. The principle, who's telling me that is an obligation? Who's telling me that is permissible? Why you make me here to tell me if you don't do it, you're going to be punished? Here, if you say, if you do this, you're going to be punished. Why are you telling me this? I say, I have evidence. What is your evidence? He said, the Quran and the Sunnah. Right? So the Quran, what he tell me, I'll go to see when I read the book of Allah, there is words where he ordered me to do. The order implies obligation. That's what the usul does. Okay? So here when we say usul al-fiqh, the laws that the word of Allah, I put them under categories. So these categories are the laws. How I came to this, by understanding the intent of every words. And these words are the book of Allah. So my evidence to categorize this part are the words of Allah, which in the Quran, listen. Yes.
So when you say the usul comes from the laws and evidence, which one is the first, the laws and evidence first?
The evidence is the first. But when I come to request from you an action, you ask me for the evidence. So the law was extracted from the evidence, from the source. And the source is going to serve as evidence to convince you that this is from Allah. So the evidence are the sources of the Sharia, the sources of the law of the Sharia. So usul al-fiqh, look at the words of Quran and Sunnah. right? And then, so the words of the Quran of Sunnah here are the source. طيب, the source, the one who make the law, what we call him, we call it, legislate the law, right? He's a legislator. What is in Arabic? Musharra. The legislator is a sharia. So this is the sharia. So the sharia is the legislated law, but the legislator who is Allah. That's the sharia. That's the meaning of the sharia. So shara'a, he the one who legislate the law. But in a way of command and advice, seeking your mercy. That's the meaning of the sharia. So when we talk about the words of Allah, which is the source, come from Allah, subhanahu. So when we say al-hakimu, the lawmaker, the legislator is Allah. The Prophet, he is conveying and also legislating by the order and command of Allah, by the revelation of Allah. So this is the source. And then looking at the words, we put them into those categories. So we have two main categories. Categories related to the action of al-mukallaf or mukallaf, whatever way you want to spell it. And category related to, let's say, or category put or laws put to, let's say, plan or organize the action of the mukallaf. Plan, organize, kind of is more planning and organization of the action of the mukallaf, and we call it M. What? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, aqimu salat, aqimu salat, establish prayer. Is an order. So the related action, according to the words of Allah, are divided by five. Wajib, mandub, mubah, makruh, and haram. Yeah, three. Just, we have them here, right? This here, they're going to be another category, which is our sabab, shart, all what we said, sahih and everything, so condition, reason, so anything. Like, for example, here, example of this, time of prayer. So the time of the prayer, nothing have to do with the action, but it relate to the action. So this category, what we call it? We call it al-ahkam al-shar'iyya, al-taklifi, the law of the sharia related to the action of the mukallaf. But these are principles, I mean the general law related to the mukallaf. Because if I say this is obligation, I told you what is obligation? The salah. So the salat is an action, is going to go to a lower level, which is the fiqh. But the, to know the salat is an obligation, the word obligation is the subject of usul fiqh. This is called so ahkam taklifiyya. This is called ahkam wad. Wad'iyya. So wad'iyya. Wad. So as you see, the two big subjects of usul fiqh are to study the sources, the Quran and the Sunnah, the words, the meaning of the words, the intent of every word, to understand the sentences, the statement. From that we understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to us. He's speaking to us here, you do this, it's okay to do this. No blame on you to do this. So that's how the categories we put them. Wada? So that's the study of the sources of the Sharia. The second category is the study of the laws, the principal law of the Sharia. So if you look at the book that we're studying, from where he started? The book was that we he started to present for us the study about the words. He said, in the Arabic language or in any language, what are the type of speech? Narrative speech, affirmative speech, figurative speech, a metaphor, an order speech, which is like, you know, imperative speech. So this is to bring your attention. When you read the Quran, you're gonna say, here Allah is telling us a story. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering us to do things. Here Allah is calling the whole humankind to worship Him. Here He's calling the believer, it's you. In this calling the believer, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Shield yourself and your family from a hellfire. This is hukum, right? But are you going to implement it? This is all your life of piety, righteousness, and fairness, and you know, helping and doing good. This is all life. But yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He comes to other laws like يَا الَّذِينَ أَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ لَا تَأْكُلُوا الرِّبَى, do not devour or eat or anything of usury. So the usury is a hukum, it's haram, we know. So do not do it, it means don't touch it. The gambling, the wine, all this are from the deeds or the action of Satan. Keep away from it. Keep away, it means like it's haram. So I say, if for example someone asks you, can I go there? Say, no, keep yourself away from it. Which is me, do you have the permission to go? You don't. So keep away yourself from this door. It means it's forbidden for you to get to this door. So we understand from keep yourself away from it, it means that it's haram. So I put it under the category of the haram. So anything that comes with that words, we're going to implement haram on it. Then you look at the action behind it. So if salat, order, mean is an obligation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, keep away means haram. Let's look at the beginning of the ayah. Wine, keep away from yourself. It. Gambling, keep away yourself from it. It's haram, this haram, is haram. How do that understanding? From the word of saying, keep away yourself from it. So anything that comes with keep away yourself from it, I put it under the category of haram. Anything that comes with a wording that say, you have to do this, I put it under the category of wajib. Anything that comes with the words that is intent, no objection for you to do it. And you put it under the category of permissible, etc. So this is the usul of fiqh. So you have two categories, the study of the laws and the study of evidence. So our book, we started with the words. We said the type of speech. And then from the type of speech, we said, the speech, when I talk to you, I mean exactly what I said. But sometimes I talk to you with the way of metaphor. You know? Say today, you know, I heard, you know, someone will tell you like, oh, subhanAllah, I was reciting, listening to a very beautiful recitation. I felt myself flying in the sky. So someone will tell you, did you went to the airport, get a plane, or did you fly? I said, no, I meant flying is like feeling joyful, right? So this is speech. If we take it as is, so the one who is, you are a teacher and you tell to your students such a thing, we say every time he like a recitation of the Quran, he has to take, buy a plane ticket to fly. This is when you take it as is, right? So that's why we need to study this type of what we call the majaz in the Quran. To understand this majaz, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking to you with this metaphor to help you, to give you more, you know, understanding, more feeling, more depth, not to tell you to do things that with the common sense are not possible. So you're not saying that the Quran has things that doesn't go with the common sense. Say no, when you have to understand the speech, you know that that's part of the figurative speech or metaphor. So that's what we studied. And then from the type of the speech, we took one that we last thing we started, said al-amru, al-amr. Al-amru is order to do, command. Right? So in the command, this is going to help us to understand the words that they intend, who going to define for us these two categories. And part of this category. So every word that has behind it the intent of the order, we're going to put it under these categories. Then we're going to study at-tarku, an-nahyu, prohibition. So the prohibition, when we study it, we know what type of the words, when we see it in the Quran, every action associated to it is going to be put under these two categories. Wada? My last part, which is to see what is the fiqh. I'll answer your question about fiqh al-waqh. Where comes the fiqh? Fiqh al-waqi'ah. Al-waqi'ah is the reality or the environment that we live in. This is part of understanding the making of the law. So fiqh al-waqa, it doesn't come in the establishment of the principles, but it comes into translating in this principle into real action. We need to take the consideration of your environment, of your reality. So the environment and the reality, if someone is sick, so we have, for example, in this category, we're going to add something else, which is al-rukhsa, the permission, an excuse, istithna, an exception. So I say, who will be candidate to this exception? Because he's sick, so his reality, his environment, he cannot do that. then we extend the reality to the environment where the people they live, their reality. And this reality will be included into looking at this laws, how to be translated into reality. Because the intent, going back to the intent, is ease, right? So how to make it easy for you to implement the law of Allah in any reality possible? It cannot be, for example, the implementation of the law in a place where the whole society, everywhere there's masajid, everyone, like, you know, their schedule, even of work, is around the prayer, etc. So this will be like more rigid for those who do not come to the masjid, for example. Say, why you don't come, this is, you have this, you make it like kind of obligation to be part of the masjid every day. But in a society where there's no masjid, where it's, you know, difficult time, people are far from the deen, becomes highly recommended to come to the masjid, not an obligation. So this is what the difference. Did we change the hukum? The hukum, the law is the same, but it changed because of the reality of the people. As in the usul or in, even in the aqidah, the way you judge or you argue with someone on certain hukum depends. If you live in a city where there's a lot of scholars, or if you live, for example, in a rural place where there's no knowledge, this one, you give him excuse, this one, you don't give him excuse. So the ruling or the principle, or to forgive people because of their ignorance, say this ignorance need to be something that has a reason. So if you live in a place where there is no scholars at all, Allah will forgive you. But when you have people of knowledge around you, students of knowledge, you're not gonna be forgiven because you're the one who didn't do your work, your task. Wow.
Where came from your sources? Are there as a Quran
No, faqa al-waqa is the reality that you live in, which is mean, if we, I can take off this to go to the next step. The intent, we said, remember, every law required to have mercy, justice, and it is wisdom because it's Allah's law. Right?
Yeah.
Then, here is a container. Our container is the reality. The society you live in. This is a container. My objective is to help the mukallaf implement this law by preserving its element with an easy way. So I'm going to reshape this law to fit this container and protecting this. I give an example that is very famous. A family want to buy a house. The law say if you're gonna use the usury, this is forbidden, right? But having a house is a necessity for a family who cannot afford, etc., etc. So you find come an exception, not changing the law, an exception with condition for certain families to be given the permission. Why? Because you want to preserve this and you want to preserve this. So you make an exception to fit that family within this reality by helping them to implement fully the law of Allah. Because if you tell them, no, it's haram, you cannot do such a thing, then you didn't give them a solution. So here when you said this is, you don't, you cannot do this, you touch the mercy. Say, where is the mercy of Allah? I cannot do it. Help me. I said, where the justice here? Say, I cannot do it, help me. I said, how you make it easy for him? You make it difficult for this person. So the hukum, instead of being have this carrying the mercy of Allah, is turned to be rigid, and it becomes like punishing you. And that's not the spirit of the Sharia that we looked at in the intent. That's where it comes, fiqh al-waqa. So fiqh al-waqa is like the recipient, the container. How to shape the law in it to help you fulfill the objective back to the beginning, to the purpose of your life. Wada. You see how everything is connected. And that's why the student of Abu Hanifa, Abu Hassan al-Qadi, he said, when they asked him why you're giving different fatwa than your own teacher, he said, I'm not opposing my teacher in the principles or in the ahkam, but this is different time. So the fatwa changed with the time. Comes to the fiqh. What they call the jurisprudence. Wada. The fiqh. Also we have laws and the evidence. As usul fiqh touch only the principles, now this give you all the details. I'll take the law, for example, prayer. What is the evidence that the prayer is from Allah, the book, the Quran, the Sunnah, the Ijma', the action of all the Ummah? That's the evidence. Now, what this prayer? In which category of usul fiqh I'm going to put it? Because I have different prayer. I have five prayer. I have witr prayer. I have tahiyyat al-masjid, etc. So when I look to the prayer, I said the five prayer, they must be under the category of wajib. Why? Because when Allah, the Prophet ﷺ told us about the five prayer, he used wording that make it fall under this category. So I don't have to make the double study to study that word. I know that word already be studied in the level of usul fiqh to tell me that is a wajib. Tahiyyat al-masjid to tell me that is a sunnah because of the wording. Now, how I'm going to pray, the details is in the sunnah. Again, when you stand, it is optional or an obligation? It is an obligation. How did I know this? Because the words that the Prophet, when he said, was teaching to the one who didn't know how to pray, he said it in a way of order. So I know this obligation. How did I know? I go to usul fiqh, said, because it fall under this category. And this is how the principle usul fiqh comes an umbrella of the fiqh. So in every action we have, you find the wudu, said the obligatory part of the wudu, the sunnah part of the wudu. How did we know that is obligatory? Because we learn it from usul al-fiqh, from what the fiqh, usul fiqh present for us as a principle to put in the small details. You say, yeah, this is belong at this category. So the fiqh here, for example, the five prayer, instead of going back to the words of Allah to check how I'm going to do it, in the base of the fiqh, I know the details, how I'm going to make ruku', sujood, etc. But to see what is the characteristic of this action, it is an obligation or not, I go back to usul fiqh. I don't need to go back up because that work has been already done. Voila. So this is the presentation which link the fiqh, with usul fiqh, with maqasid al-sharia, with the aqidah, with the purpose of life. If you have any question, inshallah. Yes.
Now, within the words of the Quran and the Sunnah, there is some explicit and implicit.
Yes.
That you can clear some implicit needs, tafsir and the needs to have more explanation. Now, when it comes to the explicit, clear message, how do you redefine that clear message by, you know, giving different interpretations, like the exception for the person that's looking for a house, for example. Now, when it comes to usury, because, you know, the argument can come up, like, the Quran is explicit about usury. Now, under what condition do you put, you make it conditional for this type of people, this family?
This is the hukum is well established, definitive, that is haram. We go up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why He implemented or ordered you for this hukm? For your good or not? For your good. He wants you to be away from transgression and He wants to shower you with His mercy and blessing. Now, when this hukm is implementation, conflict with your own well-being. So we go up, we said, is not every law need to have mercy in it? I said, yes. He said, in implementing this, I feel like I don't have a solution. Which I'll give you a better example to not be in any subject that is controversial, which is you don't have anything to eat except things haram in front of you. Allah forbid on you the haram is to have mercy on you. But now in a situation where your own life is threatening, which is bigger, to protect your life or to continue to observe the prohibition of that food? So here, there's qaida in Sharia, said, al-daruriyat tubihu al-mahdurat. State of necessity allow you to use the forbidden thing. So state of necessity becomes have an exception, would make the prohibited law or prohibited thing make it to be permissible. Why? Because you look at the intent of the Sharia. Allah wants to shower you with His mercy. It comes, for example, you have something you like, you only have, you know, someone wine in front of him. There's no water. That's all what he has. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His rahmah, to tell you, even if you kill yourself, don't drink from this. So this is what we call exception, necessity. And you apply the spirit on everything else. No, this is comes from above, from the intent of the Sharia. Because why Allah created you? To worship Him and to shower you with His mercy, right? So if He forbid you to drink wine, it's because of your good. But it comes in a situation when drinking that prohibited thing is going to save your life. Where the rahmah here is to not drink it and kill yourself, or to drink it and save your life. That's why the scholar, they say, if someone will kill or like lead to his own death, by refusing to drink that haram thing, he's in a state of major sin. He's like he commits suicide. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَقْتَلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Don't kill yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's especially merciful to you. When Amr ibn al-As, he led the companion, and he was in state of impurity. They told him, you have to wash. He said, no. And he made tayammum, and he led them to pray. So when they came back to the Prophet ﷺ, they were in a mission. They complained to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, he led us in a state of impurity. He said, what did you do that? He said, I remember Allah is saying, do not kill yourself. He was merciful to you. And what does it mean? That if he had taken a shower or washed himself in a cold night, he could have killed himself. So the Prophet ﷺ smiled. So he confirmed his hukum, because it was a state that he was protecting himself, protecting his life. What? So that's why everything is interconnected. We cannot look at the fiqh without looking at the usul fiqh, and we cannot look at the usul fiqh without looking at maqasid al-sharia, the intent of the sharia. And we cannot look at the fiqh without looking at the aqidah. Because everything comes from your belief. While you pray, you're not, you know, executing form, or you're not executing rules. You are worshipping Allah. Yes?
So these are all means for necessity?
Yes, for necessity, of course. For necessity. I mean, there's a lot of details and vast analysis in that. That we say exceptions. If someone tell you, for example, oh, in the society of today, as the usury is, you know, spread all over, it is permissible to use it. This is changing the law of Allah. This is leading to disbelief. But if you say, because of how it's spread, for certain condition, out of necessity, we'll make an exception based on certain condition to use it, that's different. Because you didn't revoke the law, you didn't change the law, you didn't refute the law. You acknowledge the law, but you make an exception because of the reality you live in. Which is mean, if the necessity is gone, if things change, then the law is still existing, never change, and never been misrespected. That's the difference.
I think this is where it's undermined, because some people, they don't understand how the scholars and the man escape these conclusions by using all these principles. And when they ask an imam or a scholar or some fatwa, and they get an answer that they might think it contradicts the Quran, or especially something that's explicit, and it brings some type of corruption to the society.
Well, this is depends on the main thing that we called, talk about akhlaq and taqwa. Because your akhlaq and your taqwa define the way how you ask the fatwa and why you ask it. You ask the fatwa for a solution, or you ask the fatwa to shop around because you already decide what you want to do. Because the one who already decide what he want to do, he's looking for the answer that he wants. He's not looking for the way of Allah. And of course, to knock the door of people of knowledge and trustworthy.
So the sake of the fatwa, the wild exclusion we talked about here. Like we, for some, came from a culture or the environment or area that, like for some, sunset, sunrise and sunset from 6 to 6 kind of thing. So it was easy for us, like sunset, sunset for some. So if an individual lives in a place where, for some, sun doesn't set. So that is the situation in the environment in this situation. With that, mostly the individual need to have a buzzword, to have a share and have a buzzword, or they can make their own conclusion and say this is necessary, so we have to do what we need to do.
I mean, for a place where the sun doesn't set, they need also the fatwa, because the fatwa to determine to them when to break their fast, even though the sun doesn't set. So not someone like in one family, someone who judge, okay, after 10 hours, I will do my iftar. The other one will say, no, 9 hours. The other one, right. So here, to come to the unity, people of knowledge who are gonna do the right ponderation, do the right calculation, the right, evaluation. But any place that it has a sunset, no one had the right, I mean, according to the strongest opinion, to break his fast before the sunset. And it's easy. If someone comes to a point who cannot finish, he has to eat. It's out of his control. And he will make it up in other days. I mean, there's these places where the sun's rise and sunset, the whole day is like 4 hours. He fasts on those days and he wants to find the fatwa in the other days. So if there's a sunset, the hukum goes up to the sunset. And the one who cannot make it, because that's out of his, he cannot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't burden anyone more than he can bear. So he will break his fast, and then he will make it up in the days that they are standard days. But to change the hukum and say, this is, is a long day, we reduce it. You never know, a long day is Allah who's feeding you. How many people there will be like scared from this Ramadan comes in the summer. And everyone after the first day, they were like normal, right? So he's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So to get that conclusion, he or she needs to have a fatwa. Again, they cannot make their own judgment, say 9, 10, 9.
Yeah, they have to. Any other question? Now, if we look at the book of Usul Fiqh, just to close this chapter, I will go only through the main sentences to relate it to what we did. So he said the book of al-Waraqat, papers, and then he gave the definition of al-Asr, the root, the principle. Then after that, the definition of fiqh, the meaning of fiqh as a knowledge. Then after that, he said the meaning of the knowledge. The fiqh is understanding and then comes to the knowledge. And after that, he gave us the definition of usul al-fiqh that we already studied. Then he said the categories of ahkam. He said wajibun, mandubun, mubahun, mahdur. Makruh, and then he adds something from al-hukm al-wadi, qala sahihun wa batil, which is related to contracts, related to type of worship. Because if you pray dhuhr before its time, this prayer is batila. So al-sahih wal-batil that he adds is from al-hukm al-wadi. So this is the ahkam, the categories of the ahkam. He mentioned that. And then he told us about the definition of every hukum. The obligatory, if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, you'll be punished, etc. So the mandub. So this is also extracted from the words. of Allah and His Messenger. The mandub, when you do it, you'll be rewarded. When you don't do it, you'll be someone will be not blamed, etc. And then after that, after giving the definition of every hukum, he went back to type of knowledge, which is now he telling you, after you know the category of the laws into the usul al-fiqh, let's look at the meaning of knowledge itself. And then he told you the meaning of knowledge, the knowledge that you don't need any tools or element to know it, because it is into your sense. When you touch something, it's hot, the knowledge that that thing is hot, so it comes with the sense. And then the second knowledge, which is this knowledge through analysis, through evidence, and through this he entered to the usul. So he said, وَأَمَّا الْعِلْمُ الْمُكْتَسَبُ فَهُوَ الْمَوْقُوفُ عَلَى النَّظَرِ. So the gained knowledge is based on analysis, etc. And he said, when in the analysis you need to find a guide, a sign, like experimentation in the lab, for our type of knowledge we require the delil, the evidence. And then he mentioned the types of knowledge, the certain, the doubt, the presumption, etc. And when it comes to the knowledge of the usul fiqh, he started by the main thing is al-kalam, the words. And he say, look at every language, how many type of speech. And from the type of speech, he said about the reality and the metaphor. And from that, he want to start with order. And from the order, you're going to see the category of the pillar, the wajib, the category of the mubah, and the category of al-mandub. And that's in brief, as you see, is an introduction. And the words that we've been studying is the part of the studying of the words to understand the categorization of the laws of usul fiqh. So when we're going to continue next time, we're going to, after al-amru, we're going to study an-nahi. And an-nahi is the prohibition. And to prohibit things, what are the ways used in the words of Allah and His Messenger to understand that it is a prohibition? And every action associated with this type of words, with this type of statement, means that it's haram or makruh. So this is the study. So when you go in depth, you find a lot of details. But that's what we need to know for this moment. Any question? Inshallah, also some of the notes will be posted from what the classes will be, help your own notes, and then also to have a question, inshallah. So every session of Usul Fiqh, let's start bi-idhnillah with questions. And so is an invitation for all of you to review during the week, inshallah, to try to understand and to put, questions. Any question from the sisters, especially? Again? Which book? Yeah, what page?
First
Page 10. What does he say? قول مؤلف التأليف والتركيب بمعنى عند بعضهم. That's the one. مؤلف, it means put together, written. قال قوله مؤلف أي ورقات تشتمل على معرفة الأصول. And he said قال ذلك لفظ مؤلف, مؤلف من جزئين. So أصول الفقه is a term that is put or مؤلف or some مركب composed from two parts. One is usul and the second part is fiqh. So when you look at the usul are the principle, the base, the roots, and the fiqh is understanding what is the knowledge. And then we put them together, we'll find what the meaning of usul al-fiqh, so the principle of the jurisprudence or the knowledge of the law of the Sharia. It's clear?
I don't know, I was just confused. If the explanations here around here, I was just confused with that.
التأليف والتركيب. التأليف, it's he said some of the ulama, they say التأليف والتركيب is the same thing. ألف is to put together statement to make it into a paper or an essay or a book. That's ألف. For example, a writer is called مؤلف. What تركيب is to put together, is like put blocks together. That's the meaning of تركيب. So again, when reading the sharah, many of the part of the sharah are not really relevant to the study of usul fiqh. Like these birds here. I mean, are not, someone need to go through them and not to study them in depth. Any question, sister? I prefer if you put read al-muhalla with the explanation that we do. If you read al-muhalla, add to it the explanation that we're doing in class. Because the first part, page 10 up to all the rest are not, important, if you can say, to the subject that we're studying. We start mainly from page 15, Al-Ahkam, and then he's going to come back to give the definition of Usul Fiqh that he started. For Al-Muhalla, which is the book, starts from page here, page 146. You see, it's very concise, and then the concise